This is the unauthorized, unofficial account of the biggest band in the world ever, told through eyewitness interviews with friends, colleagues, experts, and fans, using rare and previously unseen home movies, personal photographs, private memorabilia, and recently rediscovered film. This is the story of four people in an extraordinary situation. The Beatles, John, Paul, George, and Ringo. Four lads who shook the world. The Beatles. They came, they played, they recorded, they changed the face of pop culture, and they conquered the planet. And they did it all in the space of 10 short years. Rare and Unseen brings you the real events told through remarkable footage and true stories told firsthand by the people who were really there.
John was a local juvenile delinquent.
So it was John, Paul, George and Colin.
Because it was Elvis that really got me out of Liverpool, you know.
And the boys then became the Beatles, of course.
It's hard to explain to people that didn't grow up in the 60s what it was like.
They only got £10 for the whole group.
They were the best rock band on the planet at that very time.
It was a whole new sound.
Featuring rare home movie footage shot by the Fab Four themselves. Plus, the earliest ever Beatles film, digitally enhanced and revealed here for the first time. With fascinating and exclusive pictures you won't find elsewhere. As we unveil the true story behind the official version, Rare and Unseen, The Beatles.
There used to be transatlantic ocean liners sailed from Liverpool to New York. And most of the young people in Liverpool all worked on the ships. And they would come back from New York and have all these records which they'd bought. And that's how the groups got the music.
Every pub in Liverpool had different music in it from all over the world. The docks were busy. All these different cultures came in. When we heard Skiffle, which was by a guy called Lonnie Donegan, we formed the Jerry Marsden Skiffle Group.
John was a local juvenile delinquent. Everyone, your mum said, don't go near that boy, he's trouble.
Fairly tough. At school, I was always in trouble. But if I went into the tough districts and came across real teddy boys, I was in danger, you know? But I liked it, you know, being a rocker. At school, it was easier because, you know, I could control them with my head, you know? So they thought I was tougher than I was. So.
They went to Quarry Bank School. When John first broached the idea of a skiffle group, Quarry Man seemed to be the name for the group. The original lineup was John Lennon, Eric Griffiths on guitar, there's Rod Davis on banjo, there's Len Gary on T-chess bass, Pete Shotton was on washboard, and there was me on the drums. So that was the original lineup of the Quarrymen. First meeting with John and Paul was 6th of July in St. Peter's Church Hall, which is the Walton Fete. Ivan Bourne brought Paul to meet John. Because he knew that Paul was playing guitar. Paul played 20 Flight Rock on John's guitar, sort of upside down. Pete said, you know, the lads were impressed with what you did. Would you like to join the group? And Paul said yes. George must have been 3 years younger than me, I think. I mean, he was quite small. I wouldn't exactly say a scruff from speak, but he was a little bit of a teddy boy, you know. Very quiet, because he was a very young member of the band when he was invited to join the band. But just an excellent guitarist. So it was John, Paul, George and Colin.
I remember playing all the kids' clubs and all around Liverpool. We met a group called the Quarrymen Skiffle Group, which is John, Paul, George. And then we progressed from skiffle into rock and roll.
Because it was Elvis that really got me out of Liverpool, you know.
I turned from Jerry Marsden's Skiffle Group into Jerry and the Pacemakers, and the boys then became the Beatles, of course.
It's hard to explain to people that didn't grow up in the 60s what it was like, because, well, you know, anybody that didn't is just getting it second hand, but when you were there, it's quite extraordinary.
The original lineup in those days was John, Paul, George, Stuart Sutcliffe and Pete Best. Pete Best, he was very, very... an introvert, you know, very shy, very, very retiring. Now, Stuart, he was the James Dean of the band. He was an archetype, you know, very bohemian.
Yes, when I booked the Beatles to play at a venue, It was cash on the night. And then I used to pay them cash in the hand minus my 10%. It was all cash deals in those days. But they only got £10 for the whole group. But the big moment for them is when I went and got work in Hamburg. Hamburg was their school to learn how to be a Beatle. And they worked there for almost 6 months before they came back to England.
It's the Beatles! The curtains fell apart, and there they were, five leather-clad figures, bombing all around the stage. But they looked good right away, before they played a note. I thought they looked good.
It was the first time they'd appeared as an electric rock and roll band, so to speak, playing very loud for the time.
But by this time I was hooked. I couldn't believe the sound. It didn't just go over your head, it went through your body, right around. They were the best rock band on the planet at that very time. I've always said that. The sound was just tremendous, you know. So obviously I'm totally hooked on it.
And it just suddenly built up and up and up. Within a month, anywhere they played around Liverpool, it was sold out.
These four characters were on the stage, leaping about and full of energy. One thing that shone through everything else was the vitality. The vitality, the energy, the spark. They had this wonderful personality. This, I think it's partly Beatles, but partly Liverpool as well.
February 1962, the very first moving images of what was to become a global phenomenon, digitally restored and now shown for the first time.
Well, that was the first time they played for me. It was actually February the 14th. It was at Valentine's Day at Casanova Club. John Paul, George and Pete. The stage was in the corner, and it was only 6 inches off the ground, the stage, so you could barely see them at the back, you know. It would have been about 10 feet across and about 6 feet deep, almost like the cavern, a little bit bigger than the cavern, you know. It was black curtains. There was silver paper everywhere, you know, and bits of stuff hanging down. But a little bit bizarre, really. Little tiny box amps. You wouldn't believe the sound they got out of them, too, you know.
The Beatles only had three amplifiers, a set of drums and a handful of guitars, and occasionally the little organ. That was their entire equipment. They never had a light rig or a sound system.
So it wasn't bona fide rock and roll at all. It was a whole new sound with those harmonies. It was so musical. It wasn't three-chord backbeat rock and roll at all. It wasn't skiffle at all. It was harmonic, it was melodious, very advanced musically.
Suddenly, they came along, you know, and it sounded so fresh. And of course, we didn't really realise it at the time, the importance of it, but they were singing their own songs. It sounded different. And, you know, it was kind of a complete shake-up of the whole music world that we had been exposed to.
Brian Epstein was a unique manager in the British music scene from the 60s. He came into the business from record retailing, and he was a particularly enthusiastic record retailer.
Then with Epstein, he said, look, if you really want to get in these bigger places, you're going to have to change, stop eating on stage, stop swearing, stop smoking. Oh, it was a choice of making it or still eating chicken on stage. You know.
It was a phenomenal time to be young and involved.
It was so vibrant and so good.
In walked these four scruffy-looking boys, except I was quite intrigued because they all had the same hairstyle, a hairstyle that I hadn't seen before, anyway. So I thought, oh, well, perhaps this is going to be some kind of special test, you know. So with that, I went down the steps to introduce myself to them. And they in turn, you know, told me their names, John, Paul, George, and Pete. It was Pete Best then was on the drummer.
Epstein had kind of come in through the back door via George Martin, the producer, and eventually got the Beatles onto the Parlophone label.
There was the second session of Love Me Do, where George Martin this time turned up. And George came to the same opinion, that Pete Best wasn't good enough. And so that was the end of that session. Between those two sessions, the boys had obviously seen Ringo playing with somebody in the Hurricanes, I think it was, in Liverpool. And they liked him very much. He didn't say a lot, really. Ringo was quite happy to, to do as he was told.
Suddenly, on the jukebox has come this song. And almost all of us in the pub stopped because it was so vibrant and so good. And, of course, we all said, what's that track? Please Please Me by the Beatles. And after that, that's all we put on all night long.
Came together and they would. Apart from the four of them being packed with talent and charisma, they meet this young record shop man, Brian Epstein, with great ideas, great marketing ideas. So the whole thing came together, you know, the way it was meant to do.
Yeah, very successful, of course, that one, and became the first number one. And then followed, because they got this hit, the number one hit, EMI wanted an LP as quick as possible after that. That's the way it worked in those days. You had to get a hit single first before you made an LP. So they came in, booked all day, one day, to do this, to start this LP. So we started in the morning, 10 o'clock. I went through all day long. We got to the 13th song that particular day, Twist and Shout. And by that time, John's voice had practically shattered. And I thought to myself, oh, God, I don't think we're going to get through this one. Got to get it in one take. We definitely have to get it in one take for the sound of his voice, you know. And thank God we got it in one take. So that was 13 songs on the first album.
When they came along with, you know, Please Please Me and Love Me Do and that first album, it made it all possible.
What was fantastic was the Beatles were so refreshing. Suddenly you got these four boys and they were, you know, just like we were, the same age as we were. You got these four boys. And when you realise that they wrote all those fantastic tracks as well, it was just absolutely refreshing and something new. And it was just fantastic.
Suddenly, England had become the number one production of hit records. So, you know, whereas America had always been the leaders, suddenly we were the leaders, due solely to the Beatles. And that, I think, is part of history that will live forever.
It was a phenomenal time to be young and involved. It was a fantastic time. It can't happen again. You know, nothing does. It's just not going to happen again. It was a monstrously creative.
They would do like 4 or 5 hours in a studio and then do three gigs, you know, in that same day.
We did another 32-day tour, which was supporting Roy Orbison, with Jerry and the Pacemakers also on the bill, because they just had their first number one with How Do You Do It.
We were certainly as popular as the Beatles in 63.
So the show should have finished in the first half with the Beatles, opening the second half of the show with Jerry and the Pacemakers, then onto Roy Orbison.
Not as big as popular, not as big. They were always a better group, better musicians.
After the first night, the audience just didn't stop screaming for the Beatles throughout the rest of the show. So it had to be changed around. Roy Orbison closed the first half and the Beatles closed the second half. And by then, it was getting a bit unsafe for the fans and for the Beatles.
And then we slowly declined and they just got better and better.
I mean, it's a remarkable work schedule that they had. Because apart from just touring and doing two shows a night every night, whatever, they were also doing radio shows. They'd just take... Oh, we happened to be in London, so we'd pop into the BBC studios and record half a dozen radio shows for it in a day, as well as doing shows at night. The work ethic was just phenomenal. Non-stop touring and recording and promoting.
The way they looked, certainly looked then, their personalities, their Liverpudlian humour, of which they had yonks of that, all their songs, they were so singable, you know, and the lyrics were so good.
It was just suddenly this whole revolution, not only in music, but in society. Everything seemed to sort of catch light, and it all happened around 62, 63, when the Beatles first came out, and it was just a fantastic time to be a teenager, as I was.
To be absolutely honest with you, the Beatles didn't really need any producing. They knew exactly what they were going to do.
The reason they stood out was, as I've said, it was one, the material was relentlessly brilliant, and two, the charisma, everything about. Why was Paul left-handed? It's like, looked great on stage when he was doubled up with George, you know what I mean? It's, I don't want to get too emotional about it, but that in itself was an interesting aspect. It was interesting, it looked amazing. And they didn't mind a bit of choreography, did they? The woo, you know, shaking their mop tops and wooing. They didn't mind all that at the time. I'm sure Lennon resented it very deeply within a very short space of time. So did George, of course, I think.
Paul and John were writing like that all the time, you know, just any spare minute, you know, they'd be in the dressing room, in the car, in the coach, in the hotel room. They were just churning them out.
And then we gradually developed a style of our own. So the real difference was that we decided to write our own stuff.
In one of the sleeve notes that I wrote for the Beatles, I used the phrase, the fabulous foursome. And I was about to use it in the press release when I suddenly thought, no, sounds a bit pompous, that. Fabulous foursome, Fab Four. I had no idea that 40 years later, everybody would still be referring to John, Paul, George and Ringo as the Fab Four.
By mid-1963, it was just impossible for the Beatles to go anywhere.
At the beginning, they would have been travelling in a van, and before the M1 was built, you know, so it had been the A1, and it was, you know, took you hours to get anywhere, and probably you wouldn't be staying in very nice hotels, it'd be bed and breakfasts. And, I guess, you know, you just sort of stayed awake by taking a couple of pills or just, you know, smoking a cigarette or something, or... I don't know, I mean, for us, we kind of now, you can look back and say, oh, those are fantastic days, you know. But for bands like them, you know, that were kind of being driven quite hard, I mean, to do two or three shows in one night, going from one working man's club to another working man's club, I don't know how long they played. I mean, obviously in the later days, they just would have played like 20 minutes.
The key thing to remember about the Beatles going away on these holidays and on these trips is that actually this was pretty rare. Holidays, particularly foreign holidays, were a rarity. If you went abroad, if you went, you know, to one of the Channel Islands, or you went to France or Italy or something, I mean, that was a big event. That means that, in a sense, the Beatles are kind of living the fantasy of ordinary people by going on these holidays and by going abroad. They're doing things that most people can only dream about. For Ringo in particular, it would be very exciting to go away to Jersey. But it's a sign of how poor his family was, I suppose, that he wanted to record it for posterity, but he had to go and borrow a cine camera from his milkman to film it, because obviously his parents wouldn't have anything like that and his family wouldn't have anything like that. So he borrows the cine camera, and that's why we now have this footage of the Beatles at play.
Chords of Someone Like She Loves You, it's very ordinary chords. It's like dang, 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 dang. But the melody on top, you know, you don't actually realise it. I mean, I've got the Beatles chord sheet, chord books at home, and I play them, and I'm thinking, this is, without the melody, this is so unbelievably simple. And it was what happened on top, the harmony. It's just, it's so obvious to me that I can't actually talk about it and do it justice, you know, because I've absorbed myself in it so much that it's just part of my fabric now. I just, you know, I judge every band by that standard. I judge a song by that standard. And it's not a question of living in the past, it's just a question of actually having that thing.
It wasn't until the Beatles had released She Loves You. Streets and towns were blocked full of screaming teenagers. It wasn't just like the entrance to the theatre, it was a whole town. It was the first time that this mass outbreak of hysteria had ever really been seen.
There is actually a birth date for Beatlemania. It happened in the autumn of 1963, virtually a year after the release of Love Me Do in England. On this occasion, they were coming together after a short gap and doing a programme called Sunday Night at the London Palladium, a television show, the equivalent of which was America's Ed Sullivan Show. The fact that the Beatles were doing that live and it was being plugged a lot on commercial television, on ITV, in Britain, all these kids gathered in the street outside, and the road virtually jammed outside the theatre. This made splash coverage the following morning on the front pages of various national newspapers. Beatlemania had arrived.
We just tried everything, and because we got famous, we were sort of, were said, you know, they're leading fashion. We were buying the things from the shop.
They were, in many ways, so much like we were. Skinny young lads. A little bit controversial, but not too much that it was totally offensive.
You do have this sort of tone of public life, which is all about vigour and dynamism and experimentation and adventure, and the Beatles are part of that, and part of their strength is they really tap into it and they exploit it for their music and are able to kind of ride the waves of cultural change.
You could always have a conversation with Paul. We wasn't short of conversation, that is for sure. Extremely nice, you know, lovely lad. I can't say much more about them, really, and John the same way. He was a little bit more, what shall I say, he could be quite nasty, in actual fact. Not to me, but to perhaps reporters.
Paul McCartney tends to write about characters a lot in his music, and once you give a character a musical face, then it sort of sets it in motion. It sort of prescribes the type of music that's going to come, and I think his colourful characters are, to me, one of the high spots of the Beatles' output. I think, in contrast, that to me, Lennon is much more of a rocker. And he tends to go along that route far more. So his music tends to be slightly heavier. It tends to have more of a rock feel to it. So maybe more McCartney, perhaps slightly more on the melodic side. I'm not saying that Lennon can't write melody, of course he can, but maybe more of the rhythmic element, more of the rock element coming through.
I think music is so fantastic because it is the greatest art. It's appreciated all around the world. It's not just a thing restricted by language or culture and that kind of thing. It transcends all that.
The Beatles actually reflected and constructed some of the attitudes. I think they gave the warning quite effectively in Sgt. Pepper's with the Day in the Life. I think that their attitude, we don't want to, you know, we would like to change the world, but we don't want to involve in sort of big revolutionary politics. They managed to put into the vernacular, and maybe through colourful characters, a lot of the thinking that was going on at the time. I don't think it was particularly intellectual, particularly academic. They brought it to the forefront. London was the epicentre, and very much at the forefront in terms of fashion, and also at the forefront of being seen, flaunting it.
Even their simplest, what appears on the surface simple stuff, was very literary. I mean, McCartney was writing serious narratives in the early 60s, Paperback Writer is a short story. It's a fantastic piece of work. It's top notch.
Like all great artists, or great creators, McCartney and Lennon were able to, they drew on an enormously wide range of cultural references almost without knowing it. And that's their strength, is that they're able to use so many different references. They're always experimenting, and McCartney in particular in the mid-60s is always trying to learn new things. He's learning new instruments, he's listening to incredibly kind of way out music, experimental music, electronic music, and so on. They have these kind of this capacious curiosity that is just not the case with so many other rock bands, so many other rock musicians. And I think that's what marks them out, is the constant willingness to experiment, to learn, and to try new things.
The owner of the Olympia, Bruno Cockatrix, was a very known figure in show business, and he wanted to put up a hot show with the hottest artists from France, from the States, and from England. So he took Trini Lopez from America, who had a huge hit at the time, worldwide, If I Had a Hammer. And me, I was at the beginning of my career and had many, many hits. And I was the only girl singing rock and roll in those days. And the Beatles, of course, who were the sensation already in England, but not in France so far. And so they were kind of a sensation. And people discovered them at this concert in France. And that was prior to their tour in America.
I was the drummer with Trini Lopez. And one of our venues that we were going to do was the Olympia Theater in Paris. And they said, you're going to share the bill with this little unknown group we'd never heard of in America called the Beatles. And then we had this terrific gal, Sylvie Vartan. She was on the bill with us. And I got to tell you, the Beatles, I'd never heard of them, you know, because I was from the States. They had not been to the States yet. And they were young kids, as we were young kids, and we just sort of hit it off and sort of became buddies. We were together day and night, practically. We hung out in the daytime together. Obviously, we played at night. We partied at night. And we just sort of became a family.
Well, I remember the show as a very hot ticket. And so the Beatles came, and they were like a wave that came over Paris.
Opening night, I watched their concert from the side of the stage, and I thought they were pretty good, you know. They were young kids. The music was pretty simple. Three chord rock and roll, Love Me, I Love You, simple stuff.
I loved it. I thought they looked so original, and with their haircut. But they were kind of looked outrageous for the time.
We just had so much great fun together working the Olympia, and the way the footage came about, I always took a little bit of home movie footage of where we were, what we were doing. So I had a friend of mine go up in the balcony and shoot a bunch of footage of Trini Lopez, Dave Shriver, and myself during our part of the show. I went up in the balcony and shot a piece of Sylvie Vartan's part of the show. And then I decided I wanted to shoot the Beatles too, because nobody had ever heard of them. I didn't know if we ever would in the States, even though they did go on to be some of the greatest geniuses of music, I think. So I went up in the balcony on stage right, shot this footage of the Beatles, and I just was so in love with those guys. Not so much as musicians or as a group. I was in love with the guys. They were just the best guys. So I came down on the balcony, I ran over to the side of the stage, and I shot more footage at the side of the stage. And so this few minutes of footage I have at the Beatles on stage at the Olympia Theater, I think is the only footage of them on stage at the Olympia.
The Olympia was packed, and screaming audiences, and you know, it was the era was like that. It was volcanic and loud, and everything was new for everyone, for the kids, for us, for the music.
John was a fun, fun-loving guy, and
we laughed. He had a sense of humor that was a little bit warped. And I think that's from being a musician. Musician's humor is a little bit warped. But John was one of those guys, man, he was hysterical. He was really a funny, funny guy.
And I remember John was the one that appeared to me the wittiest, and he was always joking and, you know, posing and very friendly. And he was the one who was the most outgoing, from far as I remember.
Every time we would drive by the Olympia Theater, I'd go, oh, and I'd get my camera and shoot the marquee. And then I stopped one day and I walked across the street and shot the whole front of the theater with La Olympia and the Beatles, Trini Lopez and Sylvie Vartan.
It was just a, you know, like a Broadway theater, 2,400 people. But I mean, the chairs were broken and all that, you know, it was just a very hot audience and ambiance, you know, in the backstage as on stage.
George is the one guy that I really didn't feel like I ever really got to know personally. He was a cordial guy. He was in a good mood. I never saw him out of sorts with anybody. He was always seemed to be in a good mood, but he was a little bit shy. And he was pretty quiet.
George, I don't... He was kind of more, you know, shy or something, or I wouldn't say shy, but he wouldn't... he seemed like he was a little, you know, aside from the others.
I got to ride in Paul's Austin Mini Cooper all around London, 80 miles an hour, fearing for my life. But the coolest guy, man, just the nicest, real... average, down-home kind of person to me.
Paul was, he looked very proper to me. He was always very polite and quieter.
Ringo and I got along great. Ringo, we were drummers, so we really had something in common, and we would talk about this lick or that lick or playing here or our setup.
Ringo was also outgoing. You know, he was a drummer, and he was always his drumsticks, you know, up in the air. He was cracking jokes as well, and it was a very lively young atmosphere, really genuine. And at that time, they were like, you know, very outrageous, and everybody was saying, "Oh my God, their long hair is incredible! It's terrible!" You know, they were looked like rebels.
The show was great. When you saw the Beatles in a venue such as Shea Stadium, it was not the greatest experience in the world because you really couldn't hear what they were doing. But at the Olympia Theater, all of those shows were great because of great sound and an intimacy. At the front of the stage, you were 6 feet from the front row.
Wow, I thought they were hot.
When we were closing at the Olympia, the last night, we all went to dinner after the show, and they said, "Well, day after tomorrow, we're leaving for New York to do a television show." I said, "Oh, really? That's great. You're going to America." "Yeah, we're really excited." I said, "Well, do you know what show you're doing?" He said, "Yeah, we're doing a show called The Ed Sullivan Show." I said, "You're going to love that because it's probably the number one best variety show in America at the time." John looked over at me and he said, "Yeah, but, you know, we want to do something where we can be seen in California." I said, "Well, you'll be seen in California." He said, "We'll be seen in California." I said, "Correct. It's a network show. It'll be seen all over the country." And he had a little problem with that because the country of England is the size of our state of New Jersey, you know, or New York. And so it was hard for him to understand that they'd do a show in New York and be seen in California. So they were pretty pumped up about that.
They all had 16mm cameras of their own. Paul used to film things all over, wherever he went. He just had his camera and made these home movies, and he'd edit them as professionally as he could.
Magical Mystery Tour was Paul's baby. Paul came up with the idea for this. He said to me, look, if I don't hurry into this, if I don't bring the Beatles together now to do this job, the Beatles may well never come together again as a working band. I want to avoid that. I want to try to put the group to work immediately. And therefore, the plans for recording this film, for filming the Magical Mystery Tour, would go ahead.
Paul had had the idea of Magical Mystery Tour. The song had been written during the Pepper Sessions. He came up with his idea of making a little film of a Magical Mystery Tour. And without any sort of pre-planning as such or seriously thinking about it, he virtually just got together a film crew and hired a coach and off he went.
And so we never became the Grateful Dead or the Grateful Aeroplane, as Mick Jagger calls them, you know? And so we were all as ourselves, and you can pick most of the Beatle records. A few of them are obviously of an era, but most of them sound pretty au courant, like Hey Jude, or as songs, you know, Eleanor Rigby. It doesn't matter what period, what era, that'll go down in 200 years, it's the same, you know. Maybe they'll play it a little different or with a different machine, but when it gets down to the nitty-gritty, it's the song, you know.
They were a phenomenal band live. I mean, the harmonies were spot on, perfect. The playing was pretty damn perfect. They were just tremendous. It's a shame that after the summer of 63, nobody ever really heard them play as a band. Yeah, 'cause they were just pretty hot.
So they must have been a good live band. It's just that they felt that no one was hearing it.
During the making of Sgt. Pepper, when they were experimenting musically and chemically, they weren't behaving like a group anymore. They were in the studios, they were hardly ever all there at the same time. They would just take it in turns as to who we're doing the John song today.
I think the Beatles realised that how much money there was around to be made. They started their own business virtually, didn't they? They set up Apple and decided to go into business for themselves. But as you know, businesses have to have good business heads. I'm not sure that it wouldn't have been better had they stuck to doing what they do best, writing songs and performing, you know.
The reason that Lennon eventually turned against Epstein and what he stood for was that he didn't want to be in the fabs anymore. The mop tops, the suits, which were basically a uniform. He didn't like uniformity, of course he didn't. He was a wayward character and very introspective, always questioning, you know, why are we all here and what's it all about and what happened in my childhood, you know? He's not a happy man, I don't think.
I've never seen the breakup of the Beatles as being a bad thing, a thing to be sort of mourned, to be weeping and wailing over at all, nor have I ever seen the roles of Yoko Ono or indeed Linda Eastman, the girlfriends at the time of John and Paul, as being instrumental in that. I never saw that they were to blame in any way for the breakup.
You can't mix girlfriends and wives with the group. It's not going to work.
The breakup of the Beatles was an inevitable thing, which I frankly saw as being good rather than bad. By the end of the 60s, the Beatles and their recordings were beginning to prove it, had done all that they could within the confines, the restrictions of being the Fab Four, of being a quartet of singer, musicians, songwriters. They hadn't anything more to give as a group.
They did not, at the end, and I'm sure of this, they did not have that cemented friendship they had when they put this group together in the very beginning. They became disjointed and distant from each other.
To me, the breakup of the Beatles had been something that started insidiously almost in 1966 at the end of the touring days, and gradually fermented and happened over the years. But there were other people, other forces acting at the time that did have things to gain from the breakup of the Beatles.
When they finally got out of the box of being the Beatles, they exploded individually. We all dreamed for a long time, you know what, just out of friendship stuff, they'll probably get back together and do one last album together. And boy, imagine what that album would be with the creative influence there. But that didn't happen.
To be that successful as the Beatles became, you do need a lot more than just great music, great songwriting. There's something else, the marketing thing. It can't work. They tried it with a lot of other wannabes at the time, and it didn't work to that degree. Why? Because they didn't have the essential ingredient, which is charisma. They had it in bucket loads, the Beatles, all four of them. Very charismatic people.
The test is that they're remembered in countries outside Britain and America, and all over the world, every corner of the world, people play, people listen to the Beatles, people, you know, do covers of their songs and whatnot. And I think that's the test, and that's the test that they pass, and virtually no other group even comes close.
Pop music, rock music, is culture. There's absolutely no doubt at all. And their albums, Beatles albums, many albums from the period, they still stand up today without any question. Nothing's improved. You can't improve on what those guys were doing.
They dredge everything up from British and American culture and throw it in there. And that means that they set the template, I suppose, for pop music in the next 20 or 30 years.
A couple of the Beatles are gone, but the group will never die. I don't know we'll ever have a group as big as the Beatles ever again.
It was a modern version of the Renaissance. It changed the world.
I'm not saying anything, you know, I'm just living my life,
yeah,
you know.
Just being yourself.
I'm an artist, you know. If I'm a political artist, I'm a political artist. And if I'm a religious artist, I'm a religious artist. But I'm an artist first, and all the rest is just me trying to live my life.
I think they definitely stand at the top, unchallenged at the summit. I think they're greater than any other artist or any other group, because while others were good at doing one thing, what was unusual about the Beatles was they were so good at doing so many things. They were so flexible. They showed such willingness to learn and to mature as a group, unlike almost any other group you can think of, that they transcended the kind of music with which they initially came into the public consciousness.
It's a bit like a beautiful ham sandwich. You know, Lennon and McCartney are the filling and the thing, and the couple of slices of bread are George and Ringo.
There's no question their music will live on after we're all gone. The Beatles are going to be around forever.
A DVD presentation of this program featuring extra unseen material is available on Liberation Entertainment DVD, entitled Rare and Unseen, The Beatles.